Hey folks, welcome to Digimento Education. This is Analog Electronics and Devices Lecture 2. So I believe you must have gone through the lecture 1 and well versed with the concept that I covered in the lecture 1 and marked separately as important, and you covered all those points which I marked separately as important. Okay, so as we know that analog electronics and circuits is very, very important subject, and it basically accounts for a huge marks in the gate examination and other PS and the other government examinations. So in the last lecture we ended our discussion with the DC current and the RMS currents of a half wave rectifier. Let's move on to the fourth topic of discussion under half wave rectifier, is RMS value of AC current. Okay, it's basically IRMS dash prime, RMS value of an AC current. Understood? Now, so basically your output current of a rectifier is a combination of AC and DC components, okay. So let me just quickly describe what I am trying to find out in this section. Okay, suppose there are two signals like this. Okay, this is pure AC signal, this one is a pure AC signal. So total AC component will be equal to the AC component of this signal. Okay, but in this case there is a DC component as well. Let's say the DC component is A. So the overall AC current is basically a combination of this DC current and AC current. Okay, so what I'm trying to say, what I am going to derive right now. So pay attention to this. So what is the total output current I? Will be equal to the DC component plus the AC component. Understood? So you can write I is equal to I DC plus I dash. So I'm trying to write it as I is equal to 3 plus 4 sine alpha. This is what I'm trying to write. 3 is basically the DC component, and 4 sin alpha is basically the AC component. So I'm trying to find out the overall AC component, which is combination of this DC and this is AC. This is DC and this is AC. Okay, that's what I'm trying to write here. Okay, so I is basically the AC. So we can say that I dash, I prime. That's what we are trying to find out. The RMS value of a pure AC current, I dash, will be equal to I minus I DC. But just by rearranging the terms. Okay, on both the sides. Now IRMS prime will be equal to RMS value of I prime. Understood? So what is IRMS dash? IRMS dash is equal to square root of 1 upon 2 pi 0 say 2 pi I prime square d alpha. This is normal RMS current expression. This is normal RMS. This is the way of finding out a particular RMS value corresponding to an instantaneous current or voltage or instantaneous function. Okay. So now we can write IRMS dash square is equal to 1 upon 2 pi integration 0 to 2 pi I prime square d alpha. Understood? So how can we write it as 1 upon 2 pi integration 0 to 2 pi? What can we write I dash, how can we write I dash in terms of I and IDC is equal to, then I dash is equal to I minus IDC square d alpha from the previous expression. Okay, so we can write it as 1 upon 2 pi integration 0 to 2 pi I square plus IDC square minus 2 IDC. d alpha. It's that simple. Okay, so 1 upon 2 pi integration 0 to 2 pi I square d alpha plus I dc square by 2 pi integration 0 to 2 pi d alpha minus 2 I dc by 2 pi integration 0 to 2 pi I d alpha. Understood? Now, just have a close look at this particular expression. Just have a close look at this particular expression. This expression is basically your IDC. Okay? That's basically 1 upon 2 pi integration 0 to pi I d alpha. This is IDC. Okay? So, what can we write it as it further? Now, if you just integrate this thing, what is I square? 1 upon 2 pi integration 0 to pi I square d alpha. I square is basically the, is equal to Im square by 4. This whole expression is Im square by 4. In the last lecture, we derived the RMS value of the total current. What was that? IRMS was Im by 2 and IDC was Im by 2 Im by pi. Do you remember this thing? So this expression is basically that it will be equal to Im square by 4 plus IDC square by 2 pi 0 to 2 pi d alpha. 2 pi 2 pi will cancel. IDC square will be equal to Im square by pi square. Okay, this will be equal to Im square by pi square minus this will be, this is IDC, 2 IDC square, which means that it is equal to 2 Im square by pi square. Okay, to solve this further, we get Im square by 4 minus Im square by pi square, and this is nothing but I RMS square minus IDC square. This is IRMS dash square. So hence we can write IRMS dash is the square root of IRMS minus IDC square. This is the very important expression. So in the networks, you must have studied that, for example, I'm just taking an example. Let's say IT is equal to 3 plus 4 sine 2 omega naught t plus 5 sine 3 omega naught t. Okay. This expression is only applicable to multiple frequencies. Okay. If the expression contains multiple frequencies, then you can directly apply the this particular formula to find out the RMS value, the total RMS value. So we can say that total RMS will be equal to square root of this DC has zero frequency, this 4 sine 2 omega naught t has a 2 omega naught frequency, this has 3 omega naught frequency. So all the frequencies are different. Had it been the other case, for example, in the case in which these two sinusoidal expressions have the same frequency, then first of all you have to combine these two expressions and then basically try to find out the overall RMS value with this square root expression. This will be equal to 3 square plus 4m by 2 whole square plus 5 by 2 whole square. That will be the overall RMS current. Okay, understood? So this is how it goes. Okay, this is how it goes. So this is a very important expression. You should remember this thing. Okay, so for the hardware rectifier, we have to write it for the hardware rectifier. IRMS dash will be equal to Im square 1 by 4 minus 1 by pi square. So this is for the half wave rectifier. Understood? Now let's move on to another topic of discussion, which is very important for half wave rectifier and all other rectifiers. So fifth topic is basically ripple factor, which is represented by R. Ripple factor. This is very, very important. Now, what is ripple factor? Ripple is unwanted AC fluctuations, or you can say AC component. AC component which is present in the output of a rectifier. So basically, rectifier cannot give a perfect DC. If the rectifier is used without a filter, which is RL filter or RC filter, you are supposed to get a seemingly periodic unidirectional signal, as I basically showed you in the last lecture. So something like this. This is not a pure AC signal, pure DC signal. Okay, ripple comes when we pass this signal through a filter in order to smoothen the DC output. So when you basically try to smoothen the DC output, you basically get ripples like this. Even though it's not perfect DC, you get ripples like this. Okay, even if you pass it through a filter, RC filter or RL filter, you get DC output like this. Okay, which is not a perfect DC. And then you pass it through a regulator. Okay, either it is a Zeeland regulator or an IC regulator, you get a perfect DC output. Okay. So so this is the basically unwanted AC component, which is here, unwanted fluctuations. This is what is referred to as ripple. Okay, so ripple factor is a measure of the amount of AC component. So for a perfect DC, it should be as small as possible. So we define ripple factor as RMS value of AC component. RMS value of an AC component upon DC component. That could be in terms of current, or that could be in terms of voltage. Okay. So we define R as IRMS prime over IDC, or VRMS dash by VDC. Understood? Now, so this ripple factor should be as small as possible. Okay, so since I is equal to IRMS prime over IDC, this can be written as square root of IRMS by IDC square minus 1, because we know IRMS dash is square root of IRMS square minus IDC square. This will get this. This will be equal to square root of IM by 2 over IM by pi whole square minus 1. This will be equal to square root of pi square by 4 minus 1, and this comes out to be 1.21. Ripple factor of a half wave rectifier is 1.21. This is very, 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 very important for gate and IES and PSUs. You may be asked directly, what is the value of a ripple factor of a half wave rectifier is equal to 1.21. This is very, very important. Okay, so of course you can say that the output of a half wave rectifier is basically has a greater AC component, so it's 1.21 is very, very, it's big. Okay, now let's discuss another topic of another topic. So sixth topic is this: input power. PI. So at the secondary winding of a transformer in a half rectifier, we have a pure AC voltage, okay, and we have let's try to find out the input power, the power which is present there at the secondary winding of the transformer. So we can say its input power is basically the average value of the product of instantaneous voltage across secondary winding and instantaneous current through secondary winding. Understood? Okay, so this was the secondary winding, okay, this was VI and the current flowing is I. Understood? So PI can be written as the average value of VI into II. This can be written as 1 upon 2 pi integration 0 to 2 pi VI into I d alpha. Okay, so 1 upon 2 pi, this can be written as 0 to 2 pi. VI can be written as I into RF plus RL into I d alpha. Okay, because there will be a diode and there will be resistance RL. So 1 upon 2 pi integration to 0 to 2 pi I square RF plus RL d alpha. And what is this expression 1 upon 2 pi integration 0 to 2 pi I square d alpha is IRMS square into RF plus RL. So this is the P input. This is also important. Okay, understood? This I is basically the total current, which is combination of both DC and AC component. Okay, so you can write as a combination of both AC and DC. Understood? Now let's move on to another topic of discussion. This is the efficiency. This is also important. Okay, let's discuss about that. So efficiency basically describes the ability of a rectifier to convert input power to DC power. Okay, so we define efficiency eta, which is defined as eta. Eta is defined as output DC power, DC output power divided by input power. Okay, this is how we define efficiency. DC output power upon input power. And you can divide this thing in percentage as well. So eta is defined as PDC upon PI. Okay, so into 100, it will be in the percentage. It will be in percentage. So this eta PDC, what is the output DC DC power? This is equal to I DC square into RL. The output DC power and input power we just calculated a couple of minutes ago. So this will be equal to IRMS square into RF plus RL into 100%. Okay. IDC is IM by pi whole square into RL divided by IRMS is IM by 2 whole square into RF plus RL into 100%. Okay, so if you solve, you get percentage efficiency as 40.5 RL by RF plus RL percentage. Okay, this is efficiency. What is the maximum efficiency of a Hubble rectifier when RF is equal to RL? Maximum efficiency when RF is equal to RL. That efficiency will be equal to, when RF is equal to 0. When RF is equal to 0, maximum efficiency. Percent efficiency then will be equal to 40.5%. That's basically your ideal case. When we basically consider an ideal diode present. We don't even consider, when we don't even consider the forward resistance of a diode. So that's the maximum efficiency. 40.5%. And this is very, very important. This expression is very, very important. You should know this is 40.5. Okay. Let's discuss another topic. Okay. So this one was 8th. So average or DC diode voltage. This is also important. So we denote the average, let V diode is the instantaneous diode voltage. Okay. Now, when alpha is between pi and 0 and pi, when alpha is between 0 and pi, then VI will be positive. Then VI will be, all the values of VI will be positive. And when that is positive, your diode will be short circuited. We can say that VI is positive and diode is forward biased and short circuited. Okay, so there is no potential drop across the diode. So in that case, we are considering RF is equal to 0. We are considering the ideal diode in this case. Okay, so then V diode, the instantaneous diode current, diode voltage, will be equal to I into RF is equal to 0. We're taking, it will be negligible, but we are taking 0 because we are considering to be forward bias and short circuit in ideal diode. Okay, when alpha is varying between pi and 2 pi, then VI will, all the values of VI will be negative and diode will be reverse biased and open circuited. So when VI will be negative, diode is reverse biased and open circuited. Then V diode will be equal to minus Vm sin alpha, because it will be minus VI. It will be equal to VI. This is equal to Vm sin alpha. Okay. So the VI, which is equal to VI. So VI appears across diode. So we can say that V diode is equal to 0 when alpha is between pi, 0 and pi, and is equal to Vm sin alpha when alpha is between pi and 2 pi. So you can see that this is your basically your VI and this is diode. Okay, so when VI is positive, this will be short circuited and there is a potential drop across the diode will be equal to 0. When VI is negative, now you might be confused that I am not in the reverse bias case, I am not changing the polarity of VI. You must understand that why am I not changing the polarity of VI? VI, either you change the polarity of VI or you take the negative sign in the expression of VI. That won't have any effect. That both of them will be the same. So for the reverse bias case, you're not going to do plus minus here. You are not going to do plus minus here. You are not going to do that. VI will take negative values and this will reverse bias this diode. But the potential drop will be like this. This is V diode. Okay. This is V diode. Either you change the sign of VI expression or change the polarity. Both will have this both will have the same effect. But no, do not change both. Okay. That's why V diode will be equal to Vm sin alpha from alpha lying between pi and 2 pi. So, V diode DC value will be equal to 1 upon 2 pi integration 0 to 2 pi V diode D alpha 1 upon 2 pi it lying between only pi and 2 pi Vm sin alpha D alpha. If you solve for this, you get minus Vm by pi. This is V diode DC is minus Vm by pi. Okay, this is also very important expression that you should know. Now, let's move on to another topic of discussion is no load output DC voltage. No load output DC voltage. Which is also denoted by VDC NL. It is defined as it is the DC output voltage of a rectifier when load current is zero or RL tends to infinity or RL is not connected or RL is not connected. Okay, so this is defined as VDC NL. It is basically equal to VDC when IDC is equal to 0 or RL tends to infinity. Okay, so we just have a look at the circuit diagram. Okay, so this is basically your VDC NL. We are trying to find out the DC value. This is plus minus Vm by pi. This is basically equal to V diode DC. V diode DC. Since this is secondary winding, there is only AC component present here. VI. We are talking about VI. VI is purely AC. So DC will be equal to 0. There is no DC. So you can consider DC value to be equal to 0. If you apply the KVL in this loop, we get minus 0 plus V diode DC plus VDC NL is equal to 0. VDC NL is equal to minus V diode DC. So VDC NL minus of minus Vm by pi, we get VDC NL as Vm by pi. This expression is also important. Okay. So this expression is very very important. VDC NL is equal to Vm by pi. Understood? You should remember this. All of the properties that I am jogging down here in this lecture are very very important, and it's up to you to remember all these. Otherwise, if you ever encounter the questions which basically involve the usage of such formulas and such concepts, and if you don't know the concepts, you are doomed. Okay. Now, let's move on to the other topic of discussion. So this was 9th. Yeah, this is 10th. So this is full load DC output voltage. Now we have connected a load at the output of a half wave rectifier. Okay, let's do it with blue. So it's basically the DC output voltage across a finite RL. Okay, so this is defined at VDC FL is VDC when IDC is not equal to 0. That's basically we are referring to this. This is RL. So we have VDC FL and IDC is flowing in this circuit. Okay, so VDC FL is basically equal to IDC into R, where it's RL. Okay, so you can say this VDC FL will be IDC into RL. Now what actually is VDC FL? In what other terms can we express VDC FL into? So now let me just take the next page. So basically this is basically your secondary winding part of your half wave rectifier. This is RL, this is VDC FL. Okay, so and this is resistance RF, and if there is some DC voltage, if a DC power drop across this thing, there will be some resistance across this. Okay, there will be a DC power dissipation in this secondary winding, because in this case IDC is not purely imaginary, not purely AC. We are not referring to VI, which is purely AC. VI is purely AC, but the current across the secondary winding is not AC. It is not purely AC. Okay, because for the interval 0 and pi, IDC I current, the current I is equal to Im sin alpha, which is Vm by RF plus RL sin alpha. But for another interval, which is pi to 2 pi, this diode is reverse biased and the current does not flow in the circuit. So IDC is I current is only flowing for one half cycle. It's not flowing for another half cycle. That's why there will be a DC power dissipation across the secondary winding. We cannot say there will be no DC power dissipation across the secondary winding, even though your VI across the secondary winding is purely AC. That's why we didn't write Vm by pi across this when we were finding out VDC NL. Okay, we only considered the diode DC voltage across the diode. So this should be considered, this should be clear to you. So we can say that VDC FL is equal to VDC NL minus total internal voltage drop. Total internal voltage drop. Okay, so I meant to say VDC FL will be equal to VDC NL minus IDC into R, where R is equal to R secondary winding plus RF. Understood? This is important. Okay, had it been the other case, which we shall discuss in the bridge rectifier, the current in that case, the current across the secondary winding will be purely AC, as well as the voltage and current across secondary winding will be purely AC. So there will not be any DC power dissipation. So we shall not consider RSW or the resistance of the secondary winding in that case. In that case, R will only be equal to 2RF, because it requires two diodes in the circuit. That we shall discuss later, and that will be more clearer to you when we shall discuss about the same thing. Okay, understood? So that's basically a total internal voltage drop. So as you can see that if RL decreases, if RL decreases, your IDC increases. Okay, when RL decreases, your IDC increases, total internal DC voltage drop, internal DC drop increases, and hence VDC FL decreases. Understood? If RL decreases, your IDC increases, this expression, this subtraction decreases, and VDC FL decreases. This is how it goes. This is, you should know, this is very, very important. Okay, let's go to another topic of discussion, which is 11th part. We have regulation factor. Regulation factor. So it is defined as, it's basically a measure of change in DC output voltage due to change in the load current. So we define mathematically percentage regulation is VDC NL minus VDC FL divided by VDC FL into 100%. Okay, this is VDC NL is Vm by pi minus Vm by pi plus IDC into R over IDC into RL into 100%. So VDC NL minus VDC FL is IDC into R. This will be equal to R upon RL. This is percentage regulation. Okay, where R is equal to RSW plus RF. Okay, zero regulation. Zero regulation factor indicates that the DC output voltage does not vary with load current. Zero regulation factor will be when R is equal to zero, which means the secondary winding plus RF will be equal to zero. When we are considering, okay, that's the case. So in ideal case, percentage regulation is equal to zero, where R will be equal to zero. Okay, now since we know the expression of VDC NL, so Thevenin equivalent. What is the Thevenin equivalent? So we know that VDC FL, it VDC NL minus IDC into R, which is equal to Vm by pi minus IDC into R, VDC FL. We can write it as, V out as V Thevenin minus IDC into R Thevenin. So we can approximate this thing to this. This is RL, this is VDC FL, this is V Thevenin, and this is R Thevenin, where V Thevenin is equal to Vm by pi and R Thevenin is equal to R, which is RSW plus RF. Okay, and IDC is flowing in this circuit RL, across RL. So this is basically the Thevenin equivalent of half wave rectifier. Okay, now let's move to 13th property. Its peak inverse voltage, which is also defined as PIV. Okay, so now what is peak inverse voltage? Peak inverse voltage is basically the voltage that appears across the diode when it is non-conducting, when it is in non-conducting state, it is in reverse biased. Larger the PIV, larger is the capability of a diode to bear the inverse voltage across it. Okay, so basically larger PIV is not that is not suitable or is not reliable. So it is pretty difficult to construct diodes with a large PIV, because that would increase the cost of a diode as well in order to bear large reverse bias voltage and without getting into breakdown and without damaging the diode when it is not a Zener diode. Okay, I'm talking about a normal diode which is not a Zener diode, which works in the breakdown region. So it defines its ability to bear larger voltages, larger reverse bias voltages. Okay, so it is the maximum, it is the maximum voltage which appears across the diode when it is in the non-conducting state, that is reverse biased. So PIV is defined as the magnitude of V diode maximum value in reverse biased. So minus Vm sin alpha maximum value will be equal to Vm. Okay, PIV is Vm in the for the half wave rectifier. For half wave rectifier. Okay, so for safe operation, PIV should be less than the reverse biased breakdown voltage of the diode. Let's say if PIV of breakdown voltage is 0.7 volts of a diode, and if PIV comes out to be equal to Vm is equal to let's say 1 volt, then diode destroys. So it should be as small as possible. Okay, so PIV is basically used in diode selection. If it is found that PIV is large enough and is greater than the reverse breakdown voltage of a diode, then that is rejected for the operation. Okay, let's discuss another topic of, so it will be 14. You have a form factor which we denote as F, which is denoted as F. Now, what is form factor? Form factor is the ratio of total RMS current to the average DC current across the load resistors RL. So ratio of RMS value to average value. is ratio of total RMS value upon average value. It's not AC RMS value upon average value. So we define it as form factor as defined as I RMS by IDC. We also have a peak factor. Peak factor, which is defined as I peak by I RMS. Okay. Peak factor is defined as I peak by I RMS. Okay. That we shall not discuss because not in the syllabus. So you can encounter this thing in networks. Im by 2 is Im by pi. This comes out to be 1.57. So form factor for this, for a half wave rectifier, is 1.57. Okay. So we know ripple factor is defined as IRMS dash by IDC, which is equal to square root of IRMS by IDC square minus 1, is defined as F square minus 1. So we can define the relationship between the two. R is equal to F square minus 1. This is also important. So for the ideal case, ripple factor will be equal to 0 and form factor will be equal to 1. Okay. So that's all, folks. I am ending this lecture here. So this lecture is very, very important. I am reiterating it again. I am reiterating it that the couple of lectures that I am going to cover, which are based on discussion of half-wave rectifier, full-wave rectifier, bridge rectifiers and filters, are very, very important. And you can expect ample of questions asked in the GATE examination or in the PSU examination or in the IAS examination. You have to remember all the values that I specifically mentioned as important. You should know these values. Otherwise, you will be in great trouble. Thank you very much.